In this presentation, I will be talking about the measurement of total dietary fiber using the rapid integrated procedure. This method is a modification of AOAC methods 2009.01 and 2011.25, or AACC methods 32-foot 45.01 and 3250.01. In 2010, Codex Alimentarius released their definition of dietary fiber after deliberation for over 10 years. This definition is basically a physiological definition. It includes fiber as measured by the trowel definition, plus resistant starch, plus non-digestible oligosaccharides, but this final decision on the oligosaccharides is left to national authorities. The methodology employed is AOAC method 2009.01, which was the Megazyme integrated total dietary fiber procedure. With this, the aim was to get physiologically relevant measurement of resistant starch using pancreatic alpha amylase and amyloglucosidase at 37 degrees centigrade, pH 6, but the incubation is for 16 hours. Following this, protease treatment was included. Then ASH and protein are determined on the residues and subtracted. So what is measured in this method? High molecular weight dietary fiber, including insoluble dietary fiber and soluble dietary fiber that precipitates in 78% alcohol, plus most of the resistant starch, plus most of the non-digestible oligosaccharides, or soluble dietary fiber that's soluble in 78% alcohol. Resistant starch is the most difficult dietary fiber component to measure, because the aim is to get a measure of the amount of starch that is not digested during transit through the small intestine. Resistant starch is defined as that portion of starch that is not susceptible to hydrolysis by the enzymes of the human small intestine. Thus, the aim is to get an in vitro measurement that correlates with in vivo results. In attempting to develop an in vitro method for the measurement of resistant starch, the parameters that need to be considered are enzyme type, concentration and purity, and incubation conditions such as stirring or shaking of the reaction containers, pH of the reaction, incubation, temperature and time. The principle of the measurement of total dietary fiber using the integrated procedure is shown in this slide. The sample is incubated with pancreatic alpha amylase and amyloglucosidase to affect starch hydrolysis. During this process, all non-resistant starch is hydrolyzed to glucose with traces of maltose. The pH is then increased to 8.2 before heating the sample to 95 degrees centigrade. The pH change is so that amyloglucosidase will have no action on the starch granules as they start gelatinizing at the higher temperature. And the reason for heating to 95 degrees centigrade is to denature protein so that it can be hydrolyzed by protease. The next step is protein hydrolysis, which is performed at 60 degrees centigrade, pH 8.2 for 30 minutes. Then the pH is changed to 4.5 and 4 volumes of alcohol is added to precipitate high molecular weight soluble dietary fiber. This then is recovered on a sintered glass funnel to give high molecular weight dietary fiber, which includes insoluble dietary fiber and soluble dietary fiber that precipitates in the alcohol. This is done in duplicate. Two residues are obtained. One of these residues is analyzed for protein and the second for ASH. The protein and ASH values are subtracted from the residue weight. On recovering the high molecular weight dietary fiber, the soluble fraction passing through the sintered glass funnel is then concentrated, desalted and analyzed by HPLC to measure soluble dietary fiber that's soluble in 78% alcohol, or SDFS. The incubation of sample with pancreatic alpha amylase and amyloglucosidase must be performed in a situation where the sample is suspended during the incubation. This can be performed in a shaking water bath as shown here, with polypropylene inserts to hold the bottle steady during the shaking process. Alternatively, the samples can be suspended during the incubation using a submersible magnetic stirrer as shown in this slide. The problems and challenges faced in the application of AOAC method 2009.01 to a range of food samples and ingredients are listed below. First of all, the incubation time is 16 hours, However, the likely time of residence of food in the small intestine is just 3 to 5 hours. Secondly, phosphate cross-linked starches, RS4, are underestimated. Thirdly, resistant maltodextrins are produced from non-resistant starch under the incubation conditions used. Fourth, fructooligosaccharides are underestimated using the SugarPak HPLC columns, fructotriose elutes after sucrose. Five, sodium azide preservative is essential with incubation times of 16 hours, but it is undesirable. Six, sample deionization for HPLC is tedious. 7. D-sorbitol is not considered to be the best internal standard. It is found in some fruits and food products. Choosing the time of incubation with pancreatic alpha amylase and amyloglucosidase, this is linked with the transit time through the small intestine. Numbers of publications have been reported in literature, and the time of transit seems to range between 3 and 5 hours. In our experimentation, we have decided to settle on 4 hours. In this slide, we see the time course of hydrolysis of various starches by pancreatic alpha amylase 4 kilounits plus amyloglucosidase 1.7 kilounits per assay. The incubations are performed in tubes with shaking or in bottles which are either stirred or shaken. The results are shown here. So on the top left, we see results for Hyaline 7 or a high amylase maize starch. What's obvious straight out is that the rate of hydrolysis of the starch using any of the incubation conditions is very similar. The simplest incubation is either shaking the sample in a bottle or stirring the sample in a bottle. This is what we've chose to use routinely. Under these incubation conditions, wheat starch, which is a non-resistant starch, is completely hydrolyzed in 4 hours, as shown in the top right-hand figure. Native potato starch is quite hydrolyzed, but not completely hydrolyzed, and FibroSym, phosphate cross-linked starch, and Hyaline 7 are only partially hydrolyzed during this incubation time under these incubation conditions. In this slide, we see a comparison of the conditions used in AOAC method 2009.01 and the new rapid integrated total dietary fiber procedure for measurement of dietary fiber. The AOAC method is shown on the left-hand side and the rapid integrated procedure on the right-hand side. The only difference between these two methods is that in the rapid method, incubation time is 4 hours compared to the integrated procedure for 16 hours. And the 4-hour incubation period is achieved by increasing the pancreatic alpha amylase and amyloglucosidase levels used in the test. In this slide, we see a comparison of the incubation conditions employed in AOAC method 2009.01 and the rapid integrated total dietary fiber procedure. The major difference is in AOAC method 2009.01, it's a 16-hour incubation, employing 2 kilounits of alpha amylase per sample and 0.14 kilounits of amyloglucosidase per sample. In the rapid procedure, the amount of alpha amylase is 4 kilounits per sample and of amyloglucosidase is 1.7 kilounits per sample. This slide shows a comparison of the total dietary fiber values determined for a range of samples that are traditionally used as standards in the TDF assays. We see three methods compared: the Lee method, AOAC method 2009.01, and the rapid integrated total dietary fiber method. If we look at beta-glucan, citrus pectin, large galactan, wheat arabinoxylin, casein, and wheat starch, very similar values are obtained with each method, even though in the rapid integrated procedure, much higher levels of enzyme are used. This demonstrates the purity of the enzymes employed in the assay. With high amylose maize starch, the rapid integrated procedure gives a much higher value than either the AOAC method 2009.01 or AACC method, the Lee method. Here we see the recovery of oligosaccharides of DP greater than or equal to 3 in the original samples and on incubation of the samples according to AOAC method 2009.01 and the rapid integrated TDF procedure. What is obvious looking down the oligosaccharide list from neosugars, raftulose, polydextrose, that the amount of oligosaccharide measured is very similar in either the AOAC method 2009.01 or the rapid integrated procedure compared to the original oligosaccharide. The one major difference is Advanta fiber, isomaltose oligosaccharides, which are clearly hydrolyzed under both AOAC method 2009.01 and even more so under the rapid integrated total dietary fiber method. The high molecular weight dietary fiber values obtained for a range of samples using AOAC methods 2009.01 and the rapid integrated TDF assay procedure are shown in this table. For a range of samples including bread, oat bran, pasta, bananas, garden peas, broccoli, carrots, the dietary fiber values are essentially identical or within experimental error. The major difference comes with the modified or the high amylase maize starches. So the major difference comes with FiberSym, a phosphate cross-linked wheat starch, and Hylon 7, a high amylase maize starch. With FiberSym, with AOAC method 2009.01, the resistant starch or high molecular weight dietary fiber value is 28.6%, whereas at 59.2% with the rapid integrated procedure. With Hylon 7, a high amylase maize starch, a high molecular weight dietary fiber value of 48.6% was obtained, whereas with the rapid integrated procedure, a value of 58.8% was obtained. Another problem with AOAC method 2009.01 is that under the incubation conditions employed, a resistant maltodextrin fraction is produced from non-resistant starch, and this is measured as dietary fiber, but clearly isn't dietary fiber. Under the incubation conditions of the rapid integrated total dietary fiber procedure, this oligosaccharide, a heptosaccharide, is not produced. In the measurement of fructooligosaccharides using the Waters sugar pack column, a problem is experienced. Fructotriose, which is a major component, elutes after sucrose and thus is not measured. This problem is not experienced when using the TSK columns, where fructotriose elutes as a trisaccharide and is included in the dietary fiber value. Traditionally, samples are desalted in preparation for HPLC by passing the samples through a column of cation and anion exchange resins, as shown in this slide. The permeate is collected, concentrated, and then applied to the HPLC column. Alternatively, samples can be desalted using an inline Bio-Rad desalting pre-column. The desalting columns are expensive and can only handle 20 to 30 samples. The use of the desalting column can be increased 10 to 15 fold by removing the bulk of the salt by adding the sample to a mixture of anion and cation exchange resins in a tube, as shown here, with mixing over 5 minutes. This removes over 90% of the salt from the sample. In this slide, we also see the HPLC patterns on TSK columns of A, a non-desalted sample, B, the same sample desalted in a tube with the cation and anion exchange resins, and C, sample B applied to the HPLC column through the desalting pre-column. In this work, we have generally recommended the use of glycerol as the internal standard, but diethylene glycol is an alternative and equally as useful standard. The patterns of chromatography of glucose, glycerol, and diethylene glycol are shown in this slide. In this slide, we see the changes that have been made to AOAC method 2009.01 in the development of the rapid integrated total dietary fiber procedure. First of all, the incubation time with pancreatic alpha amylase and myeloglucosidase has been reduced to 4 hours, which is physiologically significant. And this was possible by increasing the levels of pancreatic alpha amylase at AMG used per assay. Secondly, higher resistant starch and dietary fiber values are obtained for some phosphate cross-linked starches, example FiberSym. Thirdly, higher resistant starch values are obtained for native high amylase maize starch. Fourth, resistant maltodextrins that are produced on hydrolysis of non-resistant starch in AOAC method 2009.01 are not produced in the rapid integrated procedure. Complete and accurate measurement of FOS is achieved by using the TSK-GEL HPLC columns. Sodium azide is not required in the incubation buffer because the incubation times are only 4 hours rather than the 16 hours used in AOAC method 2009.01. The HPLC is simplified by desalting of the samples in the tube with resins, followed by use of the HPLC desalting pre-column. And finally, glycerol or diethylene glycol are used as the internal standard. This method was published in the Starch Journal in 2015, volume 66, pages 1 to 24, and AACC International ICC interlaboratory evaluation is currently underway.